Sai Ram, good afternoon, and welcome to the third technical session of this conference. The theme for this session is religion and spirituality, and the goal of this session is to demystify the concept of religion and spirituality. And we have with us three speakers for this session today. The first will be Mr. Jayant Kaputkar, who is the founder and CEO of STAM Interactive Solutions. Our second speaker will be Rabbi Jackie Tabak, who is the joint president of the World Congress of Faiths, United Kingdom. And our final speaker for this afternoon will be Ms. Gitanjali JB, co-founder, CEO, and dean, Himalayan Institute of Alternatives, India. She was just with us a few days ago, and we're happy to have her back again. We will begin the session with Mr. Jayant. Mr. Jayant graduated as an engineer from IIT Kanpur and has an MBA from the Faculty of Management Studies, Delhi University. Although his professional work is in the field of security technology, his main passion has been to assimilate the teachings of Vedanta in his daily life. And during his exciting journey of the last 15 years, he has seen many connections between science and Vedanta. He's very keen about studying quantum physics and space, and he reveals that the more he reads, the more he finds that there's a lot that science can learn from Vedanta. And he's compiled all of this into a book called Science Meets Vedanta. Mr. Jayant, please.
Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure to come here. What a lovely campus we have out here. It's an honor to come and talk in this session out here. So, thank you for the introduction. What I'm going to talk today is what science can learn from Vedanta. The short answer is science can learn a lot. Unfortunately, this is not happening. The main reason for this is science has very little understanding of Vedanta. And I can understand that because Vedanta can be a very broad subject. It covers many different aspects of our life and society. But what science needs to learn, there are some specific requirements or needs which Vedanta teaches. Science must learn those requirements if they want to understand their own profession in a much better manner. And secondly, Vedanta teachers have a limited knowledge of science. The focus of my presentation today is to show what science must learn from Vedanta, and I will show you some examples by which you will see that what science is teaching, the way science is teaching is not very correct, and they need to rework their outlook towards space and many other objects and energy and other things basically. So I will start my presentation. The first step, what one really must learn is to understand our inner core. You must understand what is inside us, the inner core, not the ego part, but the real inside inner core, basically. You must understand that. You must understand the nature and the powers of the inner core. And once you understand your inner core properly, you will see that the knowledge can be applied. That knowledge can be applied to science in many different ways. The first step is to understand our inner core. And I'm sure all the students who have been studying Vedanta know Vedanta teaches us that our inner core is Sat, Chit, Ananda. Sat out here means real. It is real not in the sense what we talk in our daily language. It's a technical real, which really means that something which is unchanging in the past, which is unchanging present, and it is unchanging in the future. So that is only thing which is Sat, which is unchanging. If you look around the universe around here, you will not find anything which is Sat by this definition, because everything in the universe is born and it dies. So it cannot be Sat. In the same way, our universe also was born 13.7 billion years. That's what science teaches us. And it will continue, but it will have an end date also. So the universe also is really not Sat. So what is Sat is something which is within us, which is unchanging, and it is present within us, and it will always be there. The other nature of Sat, it is Chit. Chit means many people or many books define this as consciousness, but I like to use the word awareness because I think awareness is a much powerful way to understand Chit. And the last part of this definition of Satchidananda is Ananda. Here, Ananda is not something which is Ananda in objects, like if you eat an ice cream, you get some happiness. That's not the Ananda I'm talking about. That Ananda is a part of the objects. But what I'm trying to tell you is that the Satchidananda, Ananda is something which is the nature of Satchidananda. But that's not the focus of our talk today. So we will try to get more details and understanding what exactly is Chit, what is awareness. Because awareness is a very important force underlying this universe. A proper understanding of awareness will clarify a lot of doubts and understanding how the universe is built. So what is Chit? Chit is, like I mentioned, is awareness. Awareness is, to understand awareness, you need to understand experiences. So where do you have experiences? We can all say that we have experiences in the mind only. There can be no other place to have an experience. If you have an experience, you must have the experience in the mind. And these experiences are continuous. You have continuous experience. The moment you get up in the morning, till you go to sleep in the night, and also in your sleep state also, you have dreams. So you have continuous experiences in the mind. And the experience, like I mentioned to you earlier, only happens in the mind. If you decode experiences, you'll find out the experience is made of two different components. Experience must have an awareness, and it must have a form. So if you have an experience in the mind, you are aware of it usually. Or not usually, you must be aware of it. You cannot say that I had an experience today morning, but I'm not aware of it. So experiences must have awareness. Awareness is an important ingredient of experience. So if whenever you have an experience, you must have awareness also. But the form, which is can change, you can have forms which can come from your visual, it can come from sound, it can come from touch, it can come from taste, it can come from feeling, it can come from your internal memories, the form, and that form superimposes on awareness to complete the experience as such. So the forms keep changing, and with the form changing, the experience also keeps changing, but the awareness part of it is always in the mind. So the question is, can be asked out here, since I have awareness in my mind, you have awareness in your mind, and every living being has awareness in the mind, does that mean that there are different awarenesses in each mind? No. Vedanta teaches us there is one awareness which is in everyone's mind. So all the minds you see around every living being, they have experiences. If they have experiences, they must have awareness also in the mind. The forms can change, but the awareness is in every mind. So you need to understand what exactly does this awareness mean? What is the composition of this awareness? Awareness must have three different components. It must have a subject, it must have an object, and it must have an intelligence which connects the object to the subject there. Just like water is made of two molecules of hydrogen and one molecule of oxygen, when you combine these two molecules of hydrogen and you come with oxygen, you get water. The same way, when you combine a subject and the object and intelligence, awareness is created, sort of thing. So where, if you are aware of any experience, it must have these three components. Like, for example, I'm talking right now. So there is a subject within you. If you are listening to me and understanding what I'm saying, there is a subject within you which is the listener of this talk, basically. And then my words, which are reaching you, are the object part of it. And then there is intelligence, which is decoding that object and making the subject understand what I'm talking about. So these three components are a must and ingredient of awareness as such. So wherever there's awareness, it must have these three components. There must be a subject, there must be an object, and there must be intelligence which is connecting subject with object. So just to go in a little more detail, there must be a subject who's aware of the experience. The subject is the knower of the awareness. So if you are listening to me, there's a knower within you, which is the subject who knows what I'm talking about. And if you are seeing me, there is a seer seeing within you. There's a listener within you who's listening to my talk. There's a seer who is seeing me stand on this podium out here. So there's a subject which is a part of awareness as such. And then there's an object which must be experienced. This object is a known part of awareness. So all the objects you see in the universe, so those are part of the object, and there must be an object which is part of awareness as such. And there must be intelligence, and by which the subject gets to know the object. Intelligence is the knowing part of awareness. So intelligence interconnects the subject as the object to the subject. So the object by itself could be an object. Unless the subject doesn't know what the object is, it doesn't make sense. So the intelligence decodes the object and lets the subject know that this is my talk, or this is a tree, or whatever it is as such. These are three different components, and these components are not hanging around anywhere. These are part and parcel of awareness. As well, like I mentioned earlier, water must have hydrogen and oxygen. The same way, awareness must have these three components. They must have a subject, object, and intelligence. If any one of these is missing, you will not have awareness. Like, for example, there may be objects around the universe, but if there's no subject to see the object, there will not be awareness. And the other way around, if there is a subject, but there are no objects to see around, you will not have awareness as such. And also, if there are subject and object, but there's no intelligence, which is decoding the subject, telling the subject what the object is, you will not have awareness. So the intelligence decodes and interconnects the object to the subject. So this awareness is like a bulb shining within you, and that it is radiating awareness. And this awareness must have a subject, it must have an object, and intelligence. And this awareness, there's a power of awareness. It has a power of knower. The power of knower, the power of known, and the power of known. This and knowing, this is the power which is within awareness, which allows you to have the intelligence, which allows you to make objects, and also to able to see the objects. Just to give you an understanding of what is power of known, power of known is the ability to become any object. It doesn't create objects, the power. It manipulates the awareness to create objects. For example, we have all played with Play-Doh. The Play-Doh can be manipulated to create a house. It can be manipulated to create a man. It can be manipulated to create a tree. The same way, the power of known can manipulate the awareness to become any object as such. The object is coming from your five senses, and this power then manipulates that awareness to become that object sort of thing. So that's the power of known, and that power is within you. That's the power of the awareness. Then you have the power of knowing, which is a very powerful force, and that's all a part of the awareness. The power of listening. How do you listen? Science tell you have some waves going to your eardrums, and it goes into your mind, and then science doesn't tell you who decodes that signal and makes the knower understand what you're saying. So that decoding part, which is within awareness, allows you to decode and makes you understand what it is. For example, seeing also the tree, if you see a tree, the tree image comes into your mind. It goes into your eyes, it becomes to your retina, and then science doesn't tell you anything more than that. It doesn't tell you who and why, how is decoded, who's observing it. Science is totally silent about that. But it is the power of knowing, which is the power of seeing, which has the ability to decode that signal and let the knower, which is a subject, know that's a tree you're seeing sort of thing. So that's the power of knowing. And the power of knowing is unlimited. It has the power of listening, the power of thinking, the power of talking, the power of seeing, the power of understanding, power of learning. All these powers are within intelligence as such. Our five senses are limited, so we are limited by those five senses, but the power of knowing is unlimited. And what is amazing is that power is within you, and it's within awareness, which is part of the inner core as Sat. So we can see that the importance of inner core is very important. The inner core, like you have mentioned just now, is made of a object, intelligence, and the three powers. The inner core is a subjective knowledge because it is within you. It is a subject which is within you. And with the three powers, the subject is what is really creating the objects. And the intelligence also depends on the subject. So everything which you see outside is really dependent on the subject or the inner core within you. But science is not understanding this aspect because they only are focused on the objective knowledge. They want to investigate objects, and they've done a fantastic job in investigating objects, but they refuse to acknowledge a subject. Science must understand our inner core. It must understand awareness. Must understand the external world really depends on the subject, because the subject is what is creating all the external objects as such. And with this lack of knowledge, there are many stumbling blocks which science is facing. So I will give you some examples of how science has to rework its thinking and understand the inner core to make progress. I'll give you three examples today. One is to the framework of space, how space is created, and the framework of space. And also I'll discuss makeup of objects, how really the objects are made up, and what is the energy source for the universe. So let's start off with the framework of space. Science has discovered a lot about space. They have been peering into space. These days, the telescopes are getting bigger and bigger, and they're looking deeper and deeper into space, and they have discovered a lot. They have discovered galaxies, stars, black holes. Now they estimate there are more than 1 billion galaxies, 1 billion, 10 raised to the power 9 galaxies out there, and each galaxy is made of 1 billion stars. So you can imagine the complexity and the bigness of the universe out there. So they have discovered a lot, but they still have very limited understanding about the framework of space. How is space, structure of space, what is the wiring diagram of space, what is the framework of space? They have very limited understanding. They don't understand what is the starting point of space, and they have very confused about why is space expanding, and what is the cause for space to expand. So if you look at space, I can understand the dilemma they have, because if you look at space, everything is moving in space. There's no point in space which is stationary. If you see the Earth is going around the sun. It takes 365 days to go around the sun. Then our solar system is making a rotation around the galaxy, the Milky Way. They say it takes about 228 million years, for the solar system to make one round of the galaxy. And all the galaxies are also moving apart from each other. So there is no point in space which is non-moving as such. So finding the structure of space becomes not that easy sort of thing. So we need to locate a non-moving point in space. And if we can find the non-moving point, we can say space starts from that location. We need to find, like a mathematician will say, we need to find a coordinates which is x is equal to 0, y is equal to 0, and z is equal to 0, and t is equal to 0, which is time. We need to find a coordinate which is non-moving. And if you can find that coordinate, then you can say space starts from that location there. So looking at space, it becomes difficult to find that location, because I just mentioned that everything is moving in space. So it's better to look at space from a different angle. It's look at space in terms of time, how much time light takes to reach from different objects. Let's do that. If you look at faraway stars, for example, you see a star which is 5 million light years away. That star, light will take about 5 million years to reach us. That's very far away. If you take something closer, if it takes the sun, light takes about 8 minutes to reach us from the sun. If you take the moon, light takes about 3 seconds to reach us from the moon. If you see the plane flying in the sky at 30,000 feet, light will take about 3 into 10 raised to the power minus 3 seconds or 3 milliseconds to reach us. So you can see what's happening here. As the objects are coming closer or the objects which are closer, light will take a lesser time to reach us as such. Now if you move closer, if you see a tree outside the window, a light may take about 10 raised to the power minus 6 seconds to reach us. And then if you have a computer or a phone in your hands, light will take about 10 raised to the power minus 9 seconds to reach us. So as the objects are coming closer, light is taking less time to reach us. So if you want to find the starting point, you need to find where is the point where light will take 0 seconds to reach us. So if you extrapolate it backwards, the only location where light will take 0 seconds to reach us is the observer within us. So the observer within us is in a way the starting point of space, because light is taking 0 seconds to reach us from that object. So the center of the universe, in a way, where t is equal to 0, even the other coordinates, x, y, z, is also 0. The starting point of space is the observer within you, and like I mentioned earlier, the observer within you is your inner core. So in a way, the inner core within you is the starting point of space. And that inner core is with you only. So if you move from here today and go to Delhi tomorrow, your t is equal to 0, the starting point of space is going along with you. It's not going to remain out here. Because if you use the same logic for the objects out there in Delhi, you will come to the same conclusion that the starting point of space is within you. This doesn't apply to me. This applies to everyone. Every living being can do the same logic, and they'll find that the starting point of space is the t is equal to 0 for space is the inner core or the observer within you. So science needs to understand that the starting point of space is the inner core within you. And the implication of this is amazing, because your starting point of space is within you, the starting point of space is within me, for me is within me, and for every living being is within them. So the t is equal to 0, the starting point of space for every living being is within me. What does that mean? It means that each one of us are projecting their own universe. So since your starting point of space is within you, you're projecting your own universe. My starting point of space is within me, I'm projecting my universe, and every living being are projecting their own universe. And that universe is being projected through our inner core. The inner core is within us, which has the power of the awareness and all the other different powers which I mentioned. That is what is projecting the universe outside. So science has to understand that we need to, that the inner core is very important to understand the source for space. Now let's try to understand the connection between time and space. Science tells us that the age of the universe is 13.7 billion years. So what will be the size of the universe? Because the light will take 13.7 billion light years to reach us. One light year means the amount of distance light travels in 1 year. And it has to travel 13.7 billion years. So you can see the size of the universe is 13.7 billion light years. One light year is equal to 9.46 trillion kilometers. And if you multiply this by 13.7 billion years, you can find the actual size in kilometers of the universe. It is huge. So that's the size of the universe. And if you say the age of the universe right now at this moment is 13.7 billion years, then the size of the universe will be 13.7 billion light years. What happens after 1 second? The age of the universe is now 13.7 billion years plus 1 second. So this universe has aged by 1 second. If it has aged by 1 second, then the light has to travel one additional 186,000 miles, which is the distance light travels in every second. So the universe size will be now be 13.7 billion light years plus 186,000 miles. After 10 seconds, what happens? The size of the universe will be, age of the universe will be 13.7 billion years plus 10 seconds. And then the size of the universe, because light has to travel an additional 10 seconds, which will be 13.7 billion years plus 1,860,000 miles. After 1 year, what happens? the size of the universe, the age of the universe is 13.7 billion years plus one light year, 1 year, sorry. That's the age of the universe now. So the size of the universe would be now 13.7 billion light years plus one light year, because that's the distance light has to travel there. So you can see the outer edge of the universe is expanding at one light year every year. And the other implication of this is amazing. Time is the cause for space. As time is flowing, space is expanding. And that's what is causing the space to expand. If this age of the universe was 6 billion light years, 6 billion years, the size of the universe would have been 6 billion light years. So the time is really causing the space to expand. And so it's very important for us to understand. And the outer edge of the universe is expanding at one light year every year. And you might say, if time is causing a space to be created, where does time reside? That's again a question mark to understand. And if you really decode this, the only place where time exists is in your mind. Because what is outside is space. Space only has three dimensions, so there's no place for time there. And Vedanta, and logically you can prove that time is a source of the mind. Time is a source of mind, so if you use logic, then time is creating space. The time is functioning in the mind. So the conclusion is mind is creating space. And so it's an amazing conclusion that your mind is really the cause for the space. And the mind really means your inner core is what is really making space, basically. It's a very profound statement, and it's a very logical statement to make. But you might say, Jayant, all this sounds very logical. Do you have any scientific proof to show that what you're saying is correct? Yes, I have proven in my book that what I've just mentioned to you is correct there. There is a thing called Hubble's constant, which science has observed. If you look at space, if you look at any star or a planet, which is about 3.3 million light years away, and those people have put telescopes looking at that particular star or planet, and they find out the space around that planet is expanding at the rate of 72 kilometers per second. So that's an observed fact, and it's been observed multiple times and many times. So there's no mathematical proof for that. But with this structure which I showed out here, if you say take the fixed point, because like I mentioned to you, the space starts at t is equal to zero, and that is within you, and the outer edge of the universe is expanding at one light year every year. Now, if, just like a rubber band, if you hold a rubber band on one side and you keep pulling the rubber band, what do you see? The outer edge of the rubber band will be expanding at much faster rate, and as you come inwards, the rubber band will be expanding much slower. So that is what exactly is happening to space, because one point is fixed, t is equal to zero is fixed at your inner core, and the outer edge is expanding at one light year every year. And we just seen by observation that the at a distance of 3.3, you can find out by using a proportional mathematics at 13.7 million billion years, the expansion is one light year. So what is the expansion rate at 3.2 million light years? If you do the calculation, you'll find the answer is 72 kilometers per second. So that's what Hubble's constant has been observed. But if you use this structure or framework of space, it shows that the Hubble constant is mathematically can be proven at 72 kilometers. The reason I'm saying this is to show that structure which I mentioned here of the inner core is what the t is equal to zero space starts from the inner core, and that can be proven mathematically by this Hubble's constant. So that's one aspect you've just seen, that how the inner core is very important for the creation of space as such. So you can see that science needs to learn the concepts of Vedanta, of your inner core, to really to understand the concept of space, to understand the framework of space. The same way, let's try to understand the makeup of objects. How are objects made up? The traditional view of objects is that the objects are made of atoms. They're made of atoms are made of electrons, protons, neutrons, and those protons, neutrons are made of quarks. So that's a basic known fact about objects. That's not what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you a very different and new approach to look at objects. To understand objects, you must understand what is real. I'm going to define the real little bit different from my earlier definition, which was very strict and traditional. Here I'm going to talk real in terms of what is recorded and what is live. A recorded image is not real. A live image is real. For example, you and your friend go to a cricket match, and at the last moment, you could not go, but your friend goes and sees the cricket match. So he sees a live cricket match because he's at the stadium to see the cricket match. You could not go. So next morning, you get up and you watch the cricket match on your DVR or whatever through your recording system, and then you're watching a recorded image of the cricket match. You're not watching a live image. So same concept, the live image and real image and recorded image, they're two different things. One is a recorded image, one is a live cricket match or live images or now images. So the objects you see around you, what are they? Are they recorded objects or are they live objects there? It's a very interesting question to ponder over, to understand what you see around you, are they recorded images or are they live images? You'll be surprised to know what you see around you are only recorded images. You don't see live images outside you. Everything around you are only recorded images. The same way, like you see a recorded cricket match you saw through the DVR, the same way, what you're seeing outside you are only recorded images. To understand this concept of seeing recorded images, we need to look at the universe in terms of time again. Time is a very interesting, so if you look at distances, it cannot create, it doesn't give you much information about the space there. Because you see a house which is 100 feet away, you see a plane flying at 30,000 feet, it doesn't give you much information to understand the universe. But if you look at the same objects in terms of time, how much time light takes from coming to those universe, it gives you a completely new perspective to look at the universe. For example, this example out here, look at the sun. Light takes 8 minutes to reach from the sun. So the object, the sun you're looking at is not a real sun. You're looking at a sun which is now minus 8 minutes because light has taken 8 minutes to reach you. So you're not seeing a now version of the sun. You're seeing a recorded version of the sun, and the version is now minus 8 minutes. So it's a recorded image you're seeing of the sun, of now minus 8 minutes. If you look at the moon, you're seeing a now minus 3 minutes is not correct. It should be now minus 3 seconds image of the sun. It's not a real image of the sun. It is a recorded image of the sun you're seeing because it's a now minus. Because in the 8 minutes, the sun has moved somewhere else. It's not at that location. It's not there at all. So it's not a real object. You're seeing a recorded version of that sun. If you look at the plane flying at 30,000 feet, you're seeing a now minus 3 millisecond version of the sun. The tree outside the door, window, you're seeing a now minus 10 raised to the power minus 9 seconds. You may say, or 10 raised to the power minus 3, 10 raised to the power minus 9 are very small numbers. I agree, they're very small numbers, but they're still a recorded image. They're not live image. That's what I'm trying to say. They're not real images, they are recorded images. So everything you see around you are recorded images. So the question can be asked, where are the real objects? Where is the now version of the objects? And science has never investigated that part. They're so focused on understanding the recorded images. They're investigating the recorded images. But where is the live image? Because everything which has a recording image, there must be a live image. If you see a recorded cricket match, there must have been a live cricket match before that. If you're seeing recorded objects all around you, there must have been a live live objects before you. So where are the live objects? That's a very interesting question, and we'll try to investigate that. Where are those live objects? So to understand where are the live objects, I've given an example of the sun again. Light takes 8 minutes to reach us from the sun. So the sun, the version of the sun you're seeing is a now minus 8 minutes version of the sun. So let's do a thought experiment. If the sun can move inwards, it can, like a thought experiment, the sun moves inwards. If the sun comes half a distance now, So you're seeing a now minus 4 seconds, 4 minutes version of the sun, because light is going to take 4 minutes to reach you. So if the sun moves in further inside, and it moves about 30 seconds away from you, so you're going to see a now minus 30 second version of the sun there. And as the sun is coming closer and closer, and then where would be the point where you see a now minus 0 second version of the sun? So where light will take 0 seconds to reach you. Just think about it. Where is that point where light is going to take 0 seconds from the sun to reach you? It's within you. So that sun which you are seeing out there is really the recorded version of the sun you are seeing now minus 8 version, but the now version of the sun is within you. This I've given example of the sun only, but you apply to all the objects in the universe, and you will come to the conclusion that all the objects in the universe are within you. And when you say within you, where can it be within you? The only location is your inner core, basically. So inner core is, again, so important to understand your the objects, to understand where the objects are. The science is so focused on the recorded images, they need to investigate the now version of the objects. So just to summarize this now and recorded object, the memory objects are the recorded objects. The now objects are live. That's what is happening. Everything happens first in the live objects and then in the recorded objects. If you see a cricket match, everything happens in the live cricket match and then you see the recorded cricket match. The same way, everything happens first in the live image, which is within you, and then you project the sun, which is now minus 8 version, or objects which are at different distances there. The memory objects functions out there. The now objects function in the mind itself. And the memory objects, there's a lot of research being done there. The science has been so focused on memory objects, they have done so much object, they're spending so much money, but they have no understanding of the live object. They have no clue about the now objects, and they're not even focused on that part of it. And that's what is really more important, to understand the now objects, then you can understand the recorded objects. So science has to really rechange its focus to understand the now objects. Last part, if I have some more time, I'll just quickly go through the energy source of the universe. By now, I'm sure if I ask you where is the energy source of the universe, I'm sure you'll guess it's within you. Because that is the only correct way to look at energy. Because where is energy? Science tells you there's so much energy all the universe. Where is that energy stored? How do you know where the energy is stored? That's, again, a very important aspect. So let's quickly go through that. To do that, you need to understand the theory of relativity, which is Einstein's theory, which he introduced in 1905. I'm not going to go very technical into that. I'll just explain to you the consequences of the theory. It says that wherever there's motion, time slows down. So time slows down, just think about it. Wherever there's motion, your clock will slow down. If you start going faster, the time slows down much more. And if you reach the speed of light, time comes to a standstill. That's what the theory of relativity is. So do we see motion everywhere? We see motions everywhere. You're walking, someone's running, the ants crawling, someone's going in the car, someone going in the plane, there's motion. As per this theory, everyone's clock is clicking at different rates. The rates are so small that it makes insignificant amount in your lifetime to make any change, but the clock does slow down. As per this theory, the clock definitely slows down. And when you reach the speed of light, the clocks will come to a standstill there. So it has been scientifically proven. They've taken a clock around the planes and made an atomic clock, and they found out time does slow down, basically. And Einstein had a thought experiment to explain this theory. If you have twin brothers, one twin brother remains on Earth, the other twin brother goes into space, and if he's traveling at 80% at the speed of light, and the Earth clock, and they travel around, he comes back, and the Earth clock shows he's traveled for 10 years, the clock in his rocket will show he's only traveled for 6 years, because he's traveling at the speed of 80% the speed of light, his clock is slowed down, he shows only 6 years, basically. He goes back on another trip, and he travels at 99.99 the speed of light. The Earth clock, after traveling for 10 years, he comes back, he shows 10 years in his clock in the Earth, but his rocket clock will show only he's traveled for 50 days. Now, another thought experiment, which is not an Einstein, this is my thought experiment. He goes at the speed of light, at 10 years, he travels around, but the rocket clock shows he's not traveled at all, because at the speed of light, the clock comes to a standstill. So it shows that he's not traveled at all. He's been there always. Now we know that the photons are the only particle in the universe which travels at the speed of light. There's no other particle in the universe which travels at the speed of light. Now, for example, now if we put a camera on top of a photon, just a thought experiment, what will the photon see through that camera? It will see nothing. There'll be no space, there'll be no time, because it's traveling at the speed of light. At the speed of light, there's no time, there's no distance, no space. So, but the observer is looking at the photon, and he sees the photon zipping away at the speed of light at maybe it's traveled 10 years. But for the photon's point of view, it has no time, it has no, space, and anything which travels the speed of light has infinite energy. So the question to be asked is, where is that point where there is no space and there is no time? It's not there in space, definitely. It has to be within you, which is outside the space-time fabric, and that's what I mentioned to you earlier, is your inner core is outside the space-time fabric. So the photon is sitting actually there, and photon is not traveling. It has always been there, because it's like I mentioned to you, from the photon's point of view, it has not traveled, it has no time, it has infinite energy. But from the perspective of the observer who's sitting and watching the photon, he's seeing it zipping around. It's a phenomenon which is amazing. It's an amazing illusion which is being created, because from the photon's point of view, it is not moved at all, because it is traveling at the speed of light. It has no space, it has no energy, it has no time, it has infinite energy, and it is sitting outside the space-time fabric. But from the observer's point, he's seeing everything zipping, he sees energy there. It's an amazing illusion which is being created by your inner core. But what is most important is that the photon is sitting within your inner core itself. So the infinite energy which is sitting within you is within you. And the infinite energy and the mind, the infinite energy is within the inner core or Sachidananda. Energy is also available in the cosmic mind and individual mind. And that energy which is in the mind is used to create space, is used to create objects. There is a method which I have discussed in my book, how space is created by that energy. But here, just to mention to you that energy which is there and the space is being created by the mind, that energy which is there in Sachinananda is used to create the space, is used to create the objects there. So as a conclusion, I would like to say that the inner core, the source of the inner core is for space, energy, and object. And the inner core, understanding the inner core is the most critical thing to understand. If you understand your inner core properly, understand awareness properly, you will understand the universe in a much better manner. Lastly, just to plug my book, I've written a book called Science Meets Vedanta, and that book is available all around in Amazon and different places. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Jayant. I think that was a very interesting talk that explored science from a Vedantic perspective, and I think we had a lot to learn from that. Our next speaker is Rabbi Jackie Tabak. Rabbi Jackie grew up in Dublin, which is in Ireland, and she became Britain's first female rabbi in 1975. For the benefit of everyone, a rabbi is actually a Jewish scholar or a religious leader and teacher in Judaism. And Rabbi Jackie is currently the convener of the European Union of Progressive Judaism's Rabbinical Court and a patron of the Jewish Council for Racial Equality. She has played a leading role in interfaith initiatives and is an executive of the Interfaith Network. She's the joint president of the World Congress of Faiths in the United Kingdom. She could not be with us here today, but she sends a special video message for all of us. May we have the video, please.
At not being able to be with you. I had previous engagements, and it would not have been ethical to cancel. But I hope that I will be able to visit you and see for myself the wonderful work you do at some time in the future. But back to the subject. A story from the Hasidic tradition, a tradition that comes from an Eastern European Orthodox Jewish sect. Two rabbis, they say, were going for a walk when they saw a man changing the wheel of his cart. At one point, he stopped to say the afternoon prayer. "How disgraceful," said the rabbi, "that a person should pray while he's changing a wheel." "How wonderful," said the other rabbi. "People think of their work when they pray, but that man is thinking of God while he works." As a Jew, I believe strongly that there is only one God who is far beyond our understanding. In Judaism, the mystic's name for that God is Ein Sof, without end. That is, there are no limits we can impose on the divine with our puny understanding. Indeed, our understanding is not even a scratch on eternity. I also, as a Jew, firmly believe that there are many equally valid paths that are required to suit the diversity of need and culture that grace this earth, and that there is a sharing of spirituality in all these paths that can be discovered and followed by the few, if not the many, and that all these different paths have links and similarities as well as differences, differences that should be celebrated. A rabbinic teaching explains this idea so well, that God can be seen as a wonderful diamond with hundreds, if not thousands, of facets. But where you stand, of course, limits the facets that an individual that you can see, that limits our understanding of the greatness that is God. A modern Jewish teacher, now sadly deceased, was Rabbi David Zeller, who lived in Jerusalem. I was privileged to learn from him on several occasions when he taught at Limud, a Hebrew word that means teaching, and is a wonderful institution, a series of conferences held each year around the world. He described the spiritual process as an inward journey to seek the oneness of life and soul that we knew in the Garden of Eden before we ate of the tree of knowledge. Referencing here part of the creation story taught in the Hebrew Bible or the Torah. He taught that because we have gained some knowledge of the material, the scientific world, we've forgotten that the world is really one. Zeller maintained that this Garden of Eden still exists in our world, a place where it's possible to experience real, deep, spiritual joy, a deep connection with the divine. But we can no longer see this garden because our limited and superficial understanding of the knowledge we have gained tends to split up the world, not unite it. Pragmatically, I liken this situation to the many doctors who, when faced by their patients, only concentrate on that area of the body that is their own, that mirrors their own speciality. And they forget that it is one person who is standing there before them, and that the pain in their left foot can also be affecting the way they feel about life. So we need, taught Zeller, to return to the home of our souls. He also taught, though, that the aim of spirituality is actually not just some selfish endeavor of experiencing in oneself great joy or calmness of spirit, or even a connection to the divine, but a humbling of the self, so that we can grow into an awareness of being part of a bigger pattern, of the greater unity of creation, and then break through the limits we place upon ourselves, and so change the way that we can help or relate to each other. I meet many people in my work who say, we're spiritual beings, but they found no support or home in any of the established religions. They often say that they've always felt that they were not alone in this world, that there is a form of greater power, or they experience a sense of oneness with creation. But generally what they describe is often a very personal, individualistic feeling shared with very few others. Indeed, in a book called The Spiritual Revolution, Why Religion is Giving Way to Spirituality, Helis and Woodhead, the authors, suggest that the emergence of spirituality is associated with post-modernity. They say that survey after survey shows that increasing numbers of people now refer to themselves as spiritual rather than religious. But I find this division between spiritual and religious life and its description as a modern phenomenon difficult to accept. I know that the word spirituality is difficult to define. Maybe seeking connections with the divine, or joy and contentment in one's soul, or an awareness of the unity of creation. But of course, these feelings have been present in many different religious paths since forever. In Judaism, the search has been strongly connected to an acknowledgement that God demands of us to care not only for our own souls, but also through our religious teachings, to look after the needs of the people and the world around us, and that we can be helped in this journey by the carrying out of religious traditions or mitzvot, the commandments, as laid down by our sages. For me, the most important starting point of all spiritual experiences is to follow through on the mental, emotion, and physical results of putting at the center of my religious life a verse from the Psalms, Shaviti Adonai Lenegdi Tamid, I have placed the Eternal One before me always. Not just when I pray, not just when I study Jewish texts, but hopefully when I engage in the modern equivalent of changing that wheel on my cart. Many people associate spirituality in Judaism with what is widely called the Kabbalah. And it is true, the teaching of Kabbalah is widely practiced nowadays in conjunction with Jewish spirituality movements. Simply put, and Kabbalah, like all mystical traditions, is of course far from being simple, but simply put, Kabbalah means literally the received tradition, and is Jewish mysticism based on a tradition usually associated with someone called Rabbi Isaac Luria of the 16th century, but there are much earlier texts, stretching back to the Jewish Bible of over 2,500 years ago. For very traditional Jews, there is an understanding that Kabbalah cannot be understood without adequate grounding in traditional learning. And of course, it can't be understood by the non-observant. And in a sense, it's true, without these foundations, sometimes bizarre rituals and customs are being sold, often at ridiculous prices to the credulous. I think here of the red bands, the red threads, sold to tie round your wrist in Jerusalem to bring you luck. But there are also modern Jewish groups who may not be quite so grounded, who may not be quite so traditionally observant, but they may be observant, of course, in other ways, who seek to use the teachings of Kabbalah to enhance their religious life without the rigidity found in many of the traditional groups. In some of these groups, there are conscious attempts that are made to heighten spirituality by contemplative prayer and the study of the mystical teachings. And both of these can lead to heightened consciousness. Serving God in this way is important and traditional. But for me, there is, of course, that also very strong understanding within Judaism that spirituality has to be grounded tangibly in daily life, in the carrying out of the mitzvot, the commandments. Judaism has never advocated the sequestering of spiritual seekers in monasteries or remote caves or on top of some stone in the middle of a desert. Spirituality for us has to take place in the world, in whatever we do. And it's understood that these practical actions to help others or the rituals that we can undertake can have infinite spiritual values. So Jewish spirituality is subjective insofar as spiritual experiences are largely internal and thus different for everyone. And it's focused on practice and experience rather than, say, just on text, dogma, or law. Though, of course, all these three things can help one's spiritual life. I once heard a modern scholar say that you can no more understand spirituality by just reading about it than you can taste a recipe by reading it in a cookbook. And that, of course, means that spirituality is an active task, confronting an individual seeker. It should make us confront such questions as, what am I doing? What is this practice? Does it work? Whatever that, of course, may mean. Has it changed who I am in relationship to the world? Am I kinder? Am I more aware of wonder and awe? Am I more open to empathy with others? There is a Jewish tradition that you should say 100 blessings each day. That's quite a task. Each blessing you say wakens up the spirituality of the moment. You know, you can take an apple and bite into it and enjoy it. Or you can take an apple. You can say a blessing, thanking God for the fruit of the tree. You can bite into it and be aware that that apple is actually unique. No one else has bitten into it before. At least you hope no one else has bitten into it. You hope there's not going to be a little invader inside. But you bite into that apple with an awareness, a consciousness of the place of the apple, the place of yourself in this world, and the creation of God. For me, on a weekly basis, the acting of the Shabbat candles in particular is important in this regard. As a modern lover of science fiction, I call it a Star Trek moment. I hope many of you have seen it. One moment, I'm rushing around the house, trying to get the dinner ready, to organize clothes, food, sermon, teaching materials the family may be for Shabbat, for the Sabbath. Then I light the candles, and I'm spirited away to what Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel, a 20th century American scholar, said. I'm spirited away to the palace in time. The light of the candles link me to family and to Jewish friends across the world, to generations past, present, and I hope future, to memories of my grandmother, whose Shabbat candlesticks I now light, to links with my mother, whom I loved so very much, and who would mystically, when she lit the candles, go like this, drawing in light into herself of the Sabbath, the spirituality of the moment. And in that moment when she hid her eyes as she lit the candles, I knew that she was reciting silent prayers, calling upon God for blessings for us, her children, as I do now for our children and our grandchildren. The flickering flames may waken within me a light to an awareness of the needs of someone I know who needs help to celebrate the Shabbat, or even the needs of a wider group torn by war. Those pictures of the wars around us are there always, are they not? I was reading the other day of how people stuck in the basements in Ukraine were using candles that they have for the festival of Hanukkah, a festival of light coming amidst darkness. And they would use these candles one by one to lighten the darkness of those terrible moments stuck in the basements as the bombs are raining down round them. And I hope they remembered the hope that comes with that festival. And of course, we also have to remember those who've been struck down by illness, the many in the world who are now suffering from famine. At this moment of joy in my own family, I'm linked by the light of the candles, the awareness of the divine, to those who need compassion and support. Sometimes mentally I make a note to make a phone call, to give more tzedakah, charitable gifts, to those causes in the coming week. Or as I say, morning blessings, mentioning the creation of the lights of the heavens, I may be filled with awe for the wonders of creation. And that sometimes reminds me of my sense of smallness in the universe. Who am I that God should take notice of me? The universe is definitely not run for my benefit. Sometimes, paradoxically, the same heavenly luminaries remind me of the importance of the things I can do to help the environment. It all depends, of course, on the day, on the mood, on the news, maybe even the weather. Spirituality can invade our inner spaces in so many different ways. Or when we've been on holiday in Israel, walking along the same stones that our ancestors trod those centuries ago, my thoughts can lead to sadness at the amount of suffering and still do hold for us. Or maybe I get a feeling of ecstasy that I can see the same mountains, the same deserts, experienced the same rapid sunsets over the Mediterranean as did my ancestors that brought us to the origins of our faith. Such connectedness with history and landscape. So many obligations to the present issues of the land of Israel. In the Torah, the foundational book of our faith, we don't hear much about the spiritual moments of our ancient teachers. Abraham, as Abraham was called at this point of the story in the book of Genesis, for example, had a vision about a covenant being made between him and God. And the text talks how when the sun had set and it was dark, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch appeared and passed through animals that had been divided and were being readied for sacrifice. A very short description of obviously a powerful moment in his spiritual development. But most of the texts in the Torah concern stories about his history and his discovery of the one God. Or Moses, so important in our faith. Moses, we know, hid his face at one point in an encounter with God because he said he was afraid to look upon God. And there's a very strange text in the book of Exodus where it says that Moses then went up Mount Sinai, of course, the place in Jewish tradition of a theophany of the giving of the Ten Commandments, that Moses went up the mountain with 70 of the elders of Israel, and there they saw the God of Israel, but under his feet was a work like a pavement made of sapphire, as clear as the sky itself. But they said, God did not lay his hand on the nobles of Israel. They saw him, whatever that may mean, of course. They saw him and they ate and drank. A very Jewish prosaic end of the vision. They sat down and had a meal together. That's what we do. And then, for example, the prophet Ezekiel perhaps recorded the strongest spiritual experiences, what we may call mystical visions. He talked of a divine chariot with sparks in the wheels. It's funny, really, the word for sparks in this biblical text is now used in modern Hebrew for electricity. So there were sparks in the wheels, and it was drawn by strange beasts with four heads. And then he had also another vision, the Valley of the Dry Bones, where he is talking about the fact that the Jewish people will continue, even after the Babylonian exile, which they were experiencing at that point, around 2,500 years ago. They were in Babylon, they'd been exiled there by the Babylonians. But Ezekiel said, no, the bones will join together again. The people will rise again. We will rise, we will survive. But in fact, most of what we know about Moses, despite this incredible spiritual connections that he had with God, concerns the many laws that he brought to us to regulate our religious life. And Ezekiel, this master of mystical vision, also explains how the sacrifices were organized in the second temple that was built in Jerusalem. God, spirituality, mystical matters are there. But Judaism sees them as part of what Rabbi Ignaz Maybaum, a 20th century German-British theologian, called a householder religion tied to family, community, and society. In a modern book of Midrashim I have on the shelves here, explanations are brought to explain the rabbinic texts, the Torah texts. And there's a Rabbi Miller, an American modern rabbi, who tells another story. He says, a noble asks an artist to paint a view of the castle garden. The nobleman is entranced at the result. He says, look, when the windows are open, the birds are flying in. Your painting is so lifelike, he said to the artist, that the birds are entering my hall and pecking at the fruit trees on the canvas. But the artist is in tears. No, he said, my painting is so lacking, he cried. If it were truly lifelike, the birds wouldn't come to the trees because they would notice the gardener in the middle of the canvas. We enjoy this world so much. We're privileged, many, many of us, to enjoy that world. And like birds, we peck at the trees around us. But true spirituality must also teach us to recognize the gardener, the unity, the creator behind what we see and what we can enjoy. The unity which we Jews call God. And we have to keep that connection to the divine within us as much as we can when we go about our daily tasks, even when we eat an apple, to illumine our inner and our outer paths, to bring the wonders of the garden of creation of Eden into our world, to make it real in our world. Because, as I'm sure you're all aware, we absolutely need this strength within us to help heal, inspire, and fill our lives with gratitude, with wonder, and that hopefully these feelings will then make us go out there and do good deeds.
Our gratitude to Rabbi Jackie for that wonderful exploration of spirituality from the perspective of Judaism, where God is nothing but oneness. Our final speaker for today will be Miss Gitanjali JB, a multi-talented, multifaceted personality with experience in entrepreneurship, fine arts, and martial arts. Miss Gitanjali has contributed immensely to setting up the Himalayan Institute of Alternative Learning in Ladakh, which is paving the way for a new system of education by integrating ancient wisdom of India with modern practices. A spiritual seeker with a deep interest in Vedanta, she teaches Vedanta and Gita in the light of Sri Aurobindo and even teaches our very own students at the university. She will address us on the topic spirituality as an adventure of consciousness, and we also request her to present a summary of today's sessions. Ms. Gitanjali, please.
Namaste, everybody. Thou has made us for thyself, O Lord, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in thee. The cry for the human for the divine could not have been better summarized than this verse by Saint Augustine. A similar cry we find in Shelley's poetry, that the desire of the moth for the star, of the night for the morrow, the devotion to something afar from the sphere of our sorrow. So the human being finds himself in this world quite alone, suffering and scared, like we just were with this noise, when he first comes into this world and does not know what to do with it. What is the purpose of it all? And hence begins his search, his journey. He finds in himself, we could say, a hollow in his heart. Something is just not enough. And therefore, the journey to fill that hollow begins. The first filling happens through his physical needs and desires. He finds that he has to be aware and take care of himself. So self-preservation is the first step. Then the individual realizes that even after he is physically well settled, there is a larger society around him. He needs another. And while he is fulfilling his personal ego and desire, he should not be stepping on the toes of the other person who is also trying to fulfill his desire. And that is what gives rise to the second conduct, we can say, of a social law. Okay, we make a social law where each one has his area of influence, as they say, that my freedom ends where your nose begins. Okay? So this is the second conduct, we could call it, towards spiritual freedom. And it is important as well. Now, once he's growing in this social law, there is a question that should the society cater to the individual's progress, or should the individual subject himself to the needs of the society? And a kind of an equilibrium is sought where both are somehow happily living with one another, the individual and the society. When some of the people are not happy with it and they are beginning to seek a deeper meaning, and that is when ethics and morality come into being. So we had the first step where it is individual desire. The second step is a social law, which we see in our judiciary, in our constitution, and all of that. And then the next stage comes when it is looking for a higher meaning, and it takes the form of a moral law or being. Then this gives rise to lots of philosophies, from communism to socialism in the political field, and lot of approaches, philosophical ideas, and so on. When, again, one of those individuals stumbles upon and comes face to face with reality. And that is what the spiritual law of being becomes. So when we talk of religion and spirituality, we should be aware of three terms here and distinguish these three: morality, religion, and spirituality. Morality, as we discussed, are mental formulations and laws to have a society that is working harmoniously and taking care of individual needs. But to understand the difference between religion and spirituality, it is important to look at the Sanskrit terms of each. Spirituality is called adhyatma, and religion is called dharma. Adhyatma, when we split it into a sandhi, which means adhi atma, under the influence of the soul or atma. When that happens, then no morality is needed, no religion is needed. As Dr. Jayant sir was mentioning, the inner core becomes the guide of one's life. But till that happens, dharma, again the word dharma is from the root dhri. Dhri is that holds, that which holds us and to what we hold on to is religion. It is the journey of those spiritual seekers who have come face to face with an aspect of reality, and in their utmost love and compassion, they have codified their experience into objective methods so that we can follow them. And all the various religions over the last 2 days we have been seeing seek that oneness, that unity. And the codification of that, the objective codification which is available for us to practice, is what constitutes religion. But the eventual aim is to realize and experience that reality. So the terms are awareness, experience, and reality. That is spirituality. Now, we see that how a life lived in dharma alone paves the path for spirituality. For instance, let's take the classical example of Arjuna in the battlefield. Arjuna exemplified the dharma of a kshatriya. The dharma of a kshatriya, he was the perfect kshatriya. He knew what was the honor of a king. He knew how it was the duty of a king to establish good over evil and how to fight for what is right. But there comes, when one is on the path of having practicing a dharma, there comes a moment when all the dharmas fail. When one comes face to face with a situation in life or something for which none of what one has been prepared for in the past, none of those codified rule books are able to help. And that forces us to delve, go back into our inner core and to experience it. And that is what is spirituality. And the beauty of Sanatan Dharma, or loosely Hinduism as it has been said, is that there are as many religions as there are number of people. Because each one of us can make our own path and our own journey for that ultimate spirituality. So we have to learn that if only 10 or 12 of the so-called codified religions are creating so much of trouble, then if each of us has his own religion, then how is it going to work? And that is what today's age is about. When Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita said, Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam raja, give up all the dharmas and take refuge in me alone, what he was essentially telling us is that the time is over when you have to follow rule books. The time is now here when each of us can have a one-on-one experience and relationship with the divine. And that seeking after that divinity is spirituality. For some time, we can follow a yoga which Patanjali has codified, or it can be a path of bhakti, or it can be a path of karma, whatever suits us. But the beauty is that each one of us can curate, and curate is the word here, each one of us can curate our own religion. And therefore, we have that freedom, that limitlessness to tread a path that takes us to to the final reality. And just as we have the institute here run many hospitals, just as a hospital cannot be complete if it does not have all the specialities and super specialities, just like a botanical garden cannot be complete unless it has all the species of flowers, just as the world cannot be complete without its diversity, so too the integrality and the fullness of the divine cannot be achieved when each of us do not follow our own unique paths and a 360-degree approach to finally reach the divine. And in fact, that is the plan that the divine had towards this evolution that it planned. Why did he make so many of us? No one of us is a copy of the other. Not just today, but across the past, in the history. When we all differ completely, even in our looks, and each of us has our own swadharma to live in this world, then don't you think that this could have been a beautiful experiment of the divine, that let me play hide and seek with myself. Let me hide from being Satchidanand into millions and trillions and infinite atoms, you know, become that, so that I can find myself back through millions of ways. And therefore, the whole concept of infinite and oneness come together. So, infinite, the reality is one, and pursuit of that is spirituality. The paths are infinite, and each of them is a religion. And instead of comparing or contrasting or finding fault with other people's paths, let us all be co-pilgrims in this path of eternity. Let us learn from other paths because it makes our own path richer. When we all go for trekking in the Himalayas, we are very happy to see other books published of the same trek because there are other trekkers who have taken different paths, and some of the sites that we missed, we can see in those books. So true unity in all religions can only happen when there is an understanding and respect for each of the paths to the same reality, because that was God's initial plan, to find himself back through millions and millions of ways. And I am happy to be the last speaker of this session. I have been a student and a practitioner of spirituality for the past 30 years. And a small Buddhist story very nicely distinguishes religion from spirituality when two monks who were crossing a river come across a lady who could not cross the river. The elder monk carries her to the other end of the shore. And after having walked a few kilometers, the younger apprentice asked, "But master, why did you carry her? Because in Buddhism, you are not supposed to be interacting with the other sex." And he said, "I dropped her there, but you're still carrying her." So the master's approach is that of spirituality, of freedom, of light, of no rules, of following that inner core, and of that of the novice is of religion, where he's following a code book. And I end with this, with a small prayer and a poem, which says that this errant life is dear, although it dies, and human lips are sweet, though they but sing of stars estranged from us, and human emprise is wondrous, yet although an unsure thing. O sky, lucent bliss, untouched by earthiness, I fear to soar, lest tender bonds decrease. If thou desirest my weak self to outgrow its mortal longings, lean down from above. Temper the unborn light no thought can trace. Suffuse my mood with a familiar glow. For it is with the mouth of clay I supplicate. Speak to me heart to heart words intimate, and all thy formless glory turn to love, and mold thy love into a human face. So the poem is saying that I am too small as a human being. I know that I am going to die one day, and yet I hang on to life. I fear to soar because I will lose these tender bonds here. So he's appealing to that transcendental self that if thou desirest, if you want me to grow to you, then you please come in my form and teach me how to grow with you. And that has been the purpose and the possibility of avatarhood in the Indian tradition. And from time to time, even the avatar comes down, because the spirituality of today, if it is not updated, it can become the religion of tomorrow. So the avatar comes down so that he can keep that spirituality updated to the modern time and age. So even the avatar updates his version of spirituality. That is why from the Vedas to Vedanta to the Gita to Shankaracharya's Bhashyas to Jesus and Buddha and Sri Aurobindo, we have had this. The Dashavatar is a story of this evolution of consciousness. The how from the fish, the evolution moves to the tortoise and then to, you know, the boar and Narasimha, and finally to the physical man, the Vamana, to Parshuram, the emotional man, Ram, the sattvic man, to Krishna, Buddha, and finally the Kalki avatar. We will believe it to be Sri Aurobindo. So this evolution of consciousness, this adventure of consciousness is spirituality. And the codification in time and space, we discussed time and space today, the codification of this spirituality in time and space is religion. And religion needs to be updated, because what was valid at some point may not be valid today. And even the avatars come down to update it. So we as human beings should be in the flow, be in the moment of evolving, because the final goal is the reaching of that ultimate reality. And let us form our own religions, our own codes of conduct, because that was the original plan the divine came here with. Thank you. It is not easy to summarize both the earlier speakers, because they were so deep and so beautiful, but I will try my best. In the first talk today, there was a beautiful amalgamation of science and Vedanta, and Vedanta or science to be a limited understanding of Vedanta, if I may say, just as Newtonian physics is a limited worldview of quantum physics. And how awareness or experience is at the core of spirituality. And very beautifully it was explained scientifically that how the beginning of both space and time is within us. And the inner core, what Sir mentioned, is like the saying, yat pinde tat brahmande, you know. The microcosm is the macrocosm. We sometimes wonder how our ancient seers could calculate the speed of light, you know, without having any instruments. Because today's science is an objective understanding through experiments, through collection of data where the senses are outside, whereas the spiritual way is a subjective understanding through experience where the senses are drawn inward. And that's what is true spirituality. And in the second speech, it was through the eyes of Judaism, it was again mentioned something which is so similar to our Vedic worldview. First of all, that spirituality is an inner journey in search of that oneness. And it is not to be sought in monasteries or caves, but in this world itself. And that was the initial idea of sacrifice in the Vedic times. The sacrifice is to participate on the earth, in the world, and make it, make the heaven on earth happen, rather than to be liberated into some beyond. And there were beautiful stories which she mentioned, and the importance was given on practice and experience and not just theories and knowledge. And the takeaway for me from that was how we can fill our lives with 100 blessings every day. So to me, this practice, this knowledge of oneness and this blessings is like the amalgamation of karma yoga, jnana yoga and bhakti yoga, which is a very, the Gita's worldview and the Vedic worldview, which was so similar to the Jewish worldview. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Gitanjali, for that wonderful summary, and also for emphasizing on the beauty of diversity and the magnificence of divine creation, which has so many different parts, but ultimately leads us to the same destination. What a wonderful session we've had, and we express our sincere gratitude to the wonderful panelists we have here today. And I request Professor Vasudev, Director of the Innovation and Incubation Center of the University, to please present a token of our love and appreciation to Mr. Jayant Kapatkar. And also a token of our love to Ms. Gitanjali. May we have a group photo, please?